Hey guys, Sean Fay-Wolfe of Diamondback Studios here, and this is the second half of my two-part video exploring the worst popular music of 2022. If you haven't seen part one, I highly suggest that you pause this video and go check out that one first. You can find it linked in the description below. If you've already seen part one, then thank you so much for returning. I hope y'all really enjoy this, because God knows I won't. Andale! Dude. I need something you prove. Morgan, what the hell? You can't do this. This ain't cool. We made a deal. I told you I had nothing left to say about the controversy around you. Everyone else clearly moved on a long ass time ago, and so right after my big rant in my summer video, I made a deal with you. You keep making good music, and I'll judge that music purely on its own merits and not bring up any of your baggage anymore. That was our deal. You agreed to that. We shook on it. I was quite looking forward to a long and happy future of quietly enjoying your bangers one after another, and then the very next thing you put out after that is goddamn this. Put 'em up to the show. It is not at all surprising to me that Morgan Wallen is not just the biggest name in country music, but one of the biggest pop stars alive. One of the largest blocks in the realm of mainstream music that doesn't seem to get nearly as much critical analysis as it deserves are kids who are really into both country and hip-hop, whether they be white city kids looking for their own musical identifier amidst the rap they're surrounded by, or those from out in the sticks that grew up with that identifier but are put off by how closed off and conservative Nashville labels can be. I know that might seem like a pretty specific intersection that's fairly niche, but trust me, the crossover there is enormous. I live in Rhode Island, one of the normiest, preppiest, most clam chowda places in America, and I can confirm from first-hand experience that Wallen is huge here. I am not surprised by the reports my friends tell me of swarms of young people in twangier states who worship Morgan Wallen as a god, which makes sense because he's one of them. She don't come from it, but now she ain't running from it. Yeah, she loving the lifestyle. Not only is Wallen the only country A-lister who's mastered social media, but he comes across on record as a genuine, approachable guy with a true passion for music, adding hip-hop influences because he genuinely thinks they're cool, making the music the way he wants to without ever losing sight of who he is. And it just so happens that who he is a guy with a 30% chance of being jocular and fun, a 20% chance of being transcendent and beautiful, and a 50% chance of being this. I need something you You Proof is not Morgan Wallen's worst song, but it is his worst single. The only thing more insane than the fact that he chose this as a lead single for his big new album is the fact that it fucking worked. I've been pulling 92 on it, feel like nothing's gonna cut it, that's the hard truth. Morgan, no. You can't just throw in trap snares and 808s over a half-finished country song and expect it to gel. You need to actually have a reason to justify the structure of it. It's like you took a tomato and dipped it in chocolate. It just doesn't work that way. Yeah, I've been sipping, I've been buzzing, shooting doubles like it's nothing. Squarely in the not-helping camp is that the country song these trap elements were artlessly tossed onto was not good to begin with. The melody stays at a low, humming drone without ever rising or resolving into anything interesting. The guitars in the bridge sound like they're having a panic attack. And I'm sorry, Morgan Wallen isn't even 30 yet. Can somebody please explain to me how he sounds like he's been huffing Marlboros for the past two decades? Morgan Wallen has always had a pretty goofy voice. It's almost like this cartoon parody of a Tennessee hick. It's a voice which can actually read as unfiltered and earnest when he's put on a song with actual weight and dignity. But if they were planning on making a song with dignity, they wouldn't have made its title a bad pun. Ain't nobody selling nothing you prove. Something's See, the joke is that Morgan Wallen keeps on drinking stronger and stronger alcohol to try and burn this girl's memory out of his mind, but nothing seems to be working. Her memory isn't fading, but he is, so he laughs at the girl, saying, "Man, if 100-proof liquor isn't working, then I must need something you proof." I don't know if you know this, but Morgan Wallen had this other song a couple years back. Yeah, I'ma need some whiskey glasses if I'm gonna make it through. You might have heard it. You know, the one where Morgan Wallen keeps on drinking more and more alcohol to burn this girl's memory out of his mind, but nothing seems to be working. His memory of her isn't fading, but he is. So he laughs at the girl and says, "Man, drinking all this whiskey is making me see the world through whiskey glasses. A yuck. I mean, give whiskey glasses this, at least it sounds like a song you would actually want to pound back whiskey to, whereas You Proof hits like a distant memory of a miserable man surrounded by a raucous, uncaring bar being remembered through a head-pounding hangover. Oh, I need something you prove. reason this shocks me as a lead single isn't just because it's so bad, but because it's so redundant. It's literally just all the worst parts of Whiskey Glasses and all the worst parts of Wasted on You Frankenstein together. You Proof pretty much embodies everything bad about Morgan Wallen both in and outside of his music. That he's a drunk idiot who doesn't tend to learn from his mistakes, and will just keep on repeating the same shit over and over again until the end of time without particularly caring about the consequences. Yeah, I've been mixing liquors trying to get you gone. Honestly, I think it's time for us to all admit that we got duped when it came to Morgan Wallen. That Airplay ban? That was all completely performative. They knew that his career was going to be just fine. I mean, let's be real. We live in an age where a third of the population are willing to actively make their lives worse if they think it means taking a stand against anything woke. And another third of the population doesn't know or care about any of this shit. All the incident did was give Nashville a chance for a bunch of PC grandstanding while they took advantage of a stealth excuse to double the limelight of their biggest album in decades by waiting a year to roll out its singles to the radio. It was already the biggest album of 2021 with zero radio promotion at all, and with the singles all over the radio in 2022, it nearly became the biggest album for the second year in a row. I think we need to face the facts. Yelling the N-word in public was the single best thing that ever happened for Morgan Wallen's career. I'm not going to make any statements about whether Morgan himself deserves to be forgiven. It's not my place to say, and even if it was, I don't know the guy personally. I don't know how sincere he is about any of the reform efforts he touted during the hiatus. You want to know what's really telling, though? The fact that after shouting the N-word, Morgan stays out of the news for a year, finally announces that he's making a comeback, and the first thing he does, literally the first thing he says to the world after his big apology tour is, hey, guys, it's cool. It's cool. I've got a black friend. It really is kind of amazing. Drill as a genre is this amazing, subversive, disruptive offshoot of hip-hop. Drill's whole thing from the beginning was that it was willing to go to darker, realer places than most other rap, returning hip-hop to its golden age roots as a bold, daring, institutional threat. A pop, bitch, that shit I don't like. It's caused a full-on moral panic in the UK for the past half a decade, and it was the sound of the BLM protests in 2020. Drill was a genre that needed to blow up. Pop Smoke gave it this amazing running start into the American mainstream with his dying breath, and 3 years later, what are the big hits of this revolutionary genre? Well, there's that Blue Cheese song, and, Central C. Oh yeah, and there's that one based on a Bruno Mars sample whose title is a pun on an Elon Musk NFT the guy bought. And out of all the post-Pop Smoke Drill hits, this was the biggest. The biggest Drill song of the year, the biggest hit on Dirk's album, bigger than any of the tracks where he went off about his fallen brothers and his struggles to survive in such a cruel world, was this. She riding a bull like car, she usually don't cool stars. I've heard reports that this collab came about because Dirk heard a demo of the hook and invited Wallen onto his album because he liked what he heard. Is that a fact? Did Morgan's voice on this song really speak to you, Dirk? Okay, look. Lil Durk seems to genuinely respect Morgan Wallen as an artist and a person. I mean, you don't go up to Kendrick Lamar, point to the most famous white guy who said the N-word of the past decade, and say, "That's my boy, you should work with him," if you don't have 100% faith in the guy. But wow, does absolutely none of that faith, respect, or camaraderie come through on record. I mean, let's call it like it is. This song feels like corporate 69ing. A song which feels like it only exists because Dirk wanted a crossover hit and Wallen needed a black guy. End of. To be honest, I kinda hope this song sounds the way it does because no one wanted to make it, because the alternative is not a good look for anybody involved. I know I gave shit to Dua Lipa and Megan for not feeling like a convincing team, but by God, Broadway Dirks by Lil Girl featuring Billy Ray Sism makes Sweetest Pie sound like fucking Stankonia. This is amateur hour shit. It sounds like something two roommates made dicking around with a Pro Tool subscription neither of them wanted to pay full price for. Not a collaboration between two of the biggest rising stars in music backed by a crew of a dozen tenured professionals. Broadway girls, Broadway girls, Broadway girls. Nothing about this sounds good. The hats are bored stiff, the backing vocals are reedy, the guitars have no power, the 808s sound AI-generated, Dirk's autotune sounds like dog water, Wallen sounds like Louis Capaldi being circumcised. Every piece of this sounds like a first draft of a piece created independently of all the other first drafts of pieces, and then laid on top of each other with a computer program on automatic settings. One thing you might have noticed about this top 10 list so far is that basically none of the songs made it on primarily because of their lyrics, which is pretty unusual for one of my lists, and while Broadway Girls doesn't buck that trend, it's mostly here for its sound, it is worth noting that this song does have an unusually bad set of lyrics. I mean, most of it is just bitter whining, where the guy who wrote Chasing You bitches about all these slutty city girls who were only after one thing. There's some other shit in there, like a bit about how he takes a girl's phone away so she doesn't spread pictures of him partying without a mask. Stay classy. But if you ask me, the most telling bit about this song is the way that it opens. I opened this segment with a joke about how the first thing Morgan did when he come back was to say, "I have a black friend." But screw that. Do you want to know what literally the first five words out of his mouth when he came back were? Don't mean it, no. I met her down at Yeah, literally, the first words out of Morgan Wallen's mouth as a so-called changed man were to give a shout-out to Jason Aldean, a walking testament to the fact that you can act like the biggest piece of shit in the world, and people will cling to you harder than ever, saying they respect you for fighting the power and taking no shit, when really they just admire you for painting your selfish detachment as nobility. And if you ask me, that shout-out is the perfect capstone to where Morgan Wallen stands 2 years after the incident. Do I think Morgan Wallen is an unrepentant piece of shit like Aldean? No, I don't. Do I think he has any ill will towards people of color? I genuinely don't think he does. But what I do think Morgan Wallen is an ignorant, lazy man who's not particularly interested in thinking too hard about anything that isn't immediately in front of him. A man who puts on a front of badass give-no-fucks independence while being happy to act as a pawn in the games of the people in charge as long as they give him his immediate comfort. For a person in a position like his, the distinction between unrepentant and lazy is completely moot. We live in a time where people in positions of power need to step the hell up and look outside of themselves. Our system is designed to protect guys who don't rock the boat when they ought to, giving the passing appearance of punishing wrongdoing, while in actuality rewarding those willing to play along with a shot of steroids behind everyone's back. Broadway Girls is musical roid rage. That's exactly what it sounds like, and everyone involved with making it should be ashamed of themselves. Broadway Girls, Broadway Girls. Okay, so that was kind of a downer. I bet that some of you guys are feeling a little bit bummed out right now, and so in order to make up for that, I'm gonna make a deal with you. I am going to play a video of an otter saying good morning to you. And in return, you need to give this video a like, subscribe to my channel, and hit that bell for notifications of new uploads. That's the deal, and the quicker you do those three things, the more time you get to spend watching this little floofer. Ready, set, go! And there we go. Thank you all so much for your support, and now, on with the show. So the band Parmalee has become a bit of a running joke in my Discord server. It actually got to the point where I was asked to make a specific anti-Parmalee channel, and I did, and it sees regular use to this day. I mean, what am I gonna say? That they don't deserve it? So take my hand, let me make you mine. I'm through waiting, taking my time. A lot of people told me that this song was their pick for one of the worst songs of the year. And trust me, if I had expanded this list by like one or two slots, it very likely would have made the cut. Boyfriend country in its purest form seems to no longer be the hot trend. The winds of Nashville seem to be blowing towards rock influence and neo-traditionalism nowadays, but Parmalee stubbornly refuses to be blown, instead electing to blow themselves by taking advantage of the blank space in Dan and Che's album cycle to provide us with the most sterile, uninteresting family values schlock they possibly can. But really, who cares? If Parmalee wants to be the band for Twilight moms who don't know what rounding second base means, then whatever, that's their niche. I'm not gonna put them at number three on a worst list just for being the most ballsless act on the planet. No, if you want to make this list, then you gotta have no balls, even when you could really fucking use some. This song only peaked at number 54 on the Hot 100, and it got next to no stream, sales, or video views over the course of 2022. However, that didn't stop Nashville radio programmers from turning it into one of the most played radio hits of the year, forcing this song onto millions of people who demonstrably did not want it. And while I'm extremely sorry for their sake, I am so glad that I get to talk about it here. Truth About You is one of those very special musical atrocities that starts out at rock bottom and continues to blow your mind over and over again with just how low it's able to reach. And it's all thanks to the man of the hour, Mr. Mitchell Tenpenny.
Yeah, this town's been telling me I've done some things I never did.
So, what's the story? Well, you see, Mitchie boy here seems to be in a bit of a pickle because his ex has been spreading some words around town about the not-so-great things he's been doing to her, and he's quite upset because his side of the story isn't being heard. I mean, after all, you know how the saying goes.
Yeah, there's two sides to every breakup. One's a lie and one's the truth. One of them went down and one was made up.
Makes sense. I mean, the world is cleanly divided into good people and bad people, and all breakups are clearly the result of one of the bad people executing an evil master plan to ruin one of the good people's lives. Nuance? Nah, that was just something made up by the Disney Corporation to trick 20-somethings into watching their cartoons. So yeah, according to Mitchell, all the shit his ex is saying about him is the lie, and his side is the truth. So naturally, he's gonna tell us all the shit that really went down, such as... yeah. Yeah, he gives us nothing. He gives no examples of the accusations against him that he's rebutting, and except for one line about this woman snapping at him and another about her talking to an old flame, both presented fully out of context, he gives no example of what the truth about her actually is. If one were being uncharitable, one might say that he's got absolutely no ammo to counter her accusations whatsoever, but man, he still really wants this woman to be afraid of him, doesn't he?
If you quit telling lies about me, I won't tell the truth about you.
Okay, let's drop the act. Truth About You by Mitchell Tenpenny is one of the most ugly, hateful songs to hit this big in recent memory. You can practically hear this guy's internal monologue saying, "Do you think I like doing this? Do you think I like telling the whole town what an awful, lying whore you are? Why are you forcing me to be the bad guy, you stupid bitch?" I'm really sorry, I know how unpleasant that is to hear, but these are palpable vibes baked into this song's very DNA. A song which, need I remind you, nobody actually sought out, but millions were forced to listen to against their will.
We both know why this ended. Girl, I caught you red-handed.
I don't think there's anything Tenpenny could have done to rub off the song's Brett Kavanaugh vibes, because I honestly think that's just the kind of guy he is.
Yeah, I don't deal with bitches no more.
Yeah, but if he had the foresight to paint any kind of specific narrative of what he claims actually happened, my problems with it might have ended there. But no, he just resorts to vague gestures and empty threats, so the song reads like a man trying to get back into a power position he thinks is owed to him but he simply does not deserve. And how could he have earned that position? Well, I'm glad you asked.
I've got my side of the story and he's got his side too.
This is What He Didn't Do by Carly Pearce, also released in 2022. It didn't get nearly as big a push as Mitchell, since country radio still isn't too big on promoting women, or as Nashville executives call them, those leggy-titted things Luke Bryan is always singing about. Despite that, it still managed to become a decent-sized country hit, which is pretty convenient for me since this song is basically a mathematic proof demonstrating literally everything Truth About You does wrong by doing literally all of it right.
So I'ma take the high road, even though we both know I could run him out of this town.
The setup is basically identical. The singer's ex is spreading rumors all around town about them, and the singer has no intentions of revealing what actually happened. There are many subtleties that make Carly's song work where Mitchell's fails, but the key difference I want to focus on is that while Tenpenny gives you no reason to believe a single word out of his mouth, Pierce does this.
I ain't gonna go and tell you what he did, but I'll tell you what he didn't do. Treat me right, put me first, be a man of his word.
Yeah, in a very clever twist, Pierce flips the script on this guy, refusing to spread the specific offenses he committed against her, but instead telling everything he failed to provide her. Pierce doesn't want to tear this guy down, she just never wants to think about him again, to cut him out of her life and move on.
Devil's in the details, I won't tell the hell that he put me through.
works both as a demonstration of her taking the high road, but more poignantly, as a defiant act of strength and affirmation of self-agency, since she doesn't want the people of this town to think of some dipshit man as the most notable thing that ever happened to her. Even without going into the details, she manages to provide a through line of emotional catharsis and release for the listener. And also, you know, she can actually sing.
Why can't we meet in the middle? Call it even, call it true.
Yeah, if any of you were wondering how this song is only number 3, it's purely because Tenpenny is such a laughably atrocious singer that I can't take him seriously for more than a few seconds. By all accounts, this song should skeeve me out, but in practice, Tenpenny sounds so awful and has so little emotional control over his voice that I just burst out laughing at it.
If you quit telling lies about me, well, I won't tell the truth.
Oh my god, you can practically hear him in the recording booth biting his lip and going, yeah, I am an artist. I am making fucking art here, man.
I don't wanna tell the truth.
It is one of the most ridiculous, overwrought performances I've ever heard. It sounds like he's got Waiting on the World to Change by John Mayer stuck in his throat, and he loves the way it feels there. And if you think this performance has any thought put into it, like this is the performance he genuinely thought was the best fit for these lyrics, well, Mitchie Boy also has a tendency of posting covers and...
Just to see you smile.
Yeah, this is just basically what he does.
I told you that I was happy for you. And given the chance I lie again.
I didn't realize it was possible to speak the words instead of singing them when the guy is literally singing. Like, this is it. This guy's one default mode is ridiculous overwrought belting that he can't turn off no matter what. I cannot think of a single song that this tone of singing would fit properly on, except, I don't know, fucking Someone You Loved or some shit.
It's easy to say.
Oh god, no!
The same. I guess I kinda like the way you numbed all the pain. Now the day bleeds, and you know you fall.
Look at that, he used some auto-tune, that's fun.
Now I need somebody to know, somebody to hear.
Oh, look at that, he added a kick drum and some 808s to Someone You Love. That's very cool, very cool of him.
When it hurts, sometimes I fall into your...
Who is this man? Where did he come from? Why is he here? Why does he have a career? Who's to say? The only thing that I know 100% for sure is that it has absolutely nothing to do with the fact that Mitchell Tenpenny is the grandson of one of the most powerful music executives in Nashville history. I don't think it's controversial to say that there are very few things in popular music as universally agreed to be uncomfortable as the first chorus of I Wanna Fuck You by Akon.
All I know you see me looking at you and you already know I wanna fuck you.
It's so spare. There are no musical complexities whatsoever, and so all of your focus is placed squarely on the lyrics. As Akon croons, you could just feel his beady little eyes combing over every inch of you that he possibly can, taking all of you in and thinking about what he wants to do to you, and it feels like a boundary has been crossed. However, I will give I Wanna Fuck You credit for exactly one thing, and it's this. This word, right here in the title. I want to fuck you. It's a desire that is unrequited, and within the confines of the song, stays unrequited. At no point are we forced to listen to this man having sex. Nashville, the fuck were you doing this year?
She likes it when I wear a suit, pick a favorite movie. When I open the...
There are quite a few ways in which I Like It by Russell Dickerson and Jake Scott are not nearly as bad as I Wanna Fuck You by Akon. The creepy power imbalance is gone. We're no longer listening to a man drooling directly into our ears over a stripper whose income depends on getting him off. We're instead listening to a man who's been happily married for 10 years singing about all the cute little things he and his wife do to make each other happy while they have a night off together. So yeah, in that respect, the song is leagues better. Everything else, Jesus Christ, where do I begin?
She likes it when I pour tequila, cause she knows that we about to have ourselves a little night.
I know what you're probably thinking. Wow, that looping vocal melody is kind of annoying. That little guitar line is the weakest thing I've ever heard in my life. That 808 is almost impressively graceless. And the percussion work is making Ringo Starr turn in his grave despite the fact that he's not dead yet. I've noticed that that one melody is still looping in the background. It's kind of weird. I wonder when it's gonna end. I don't have to say anything else. You know what the punchline is.
And I rub it back for like half an hour. Ooh, ooh, ooh.
Oh yeah, feel that. Russell Dickerson is right up in your ear. He is getting intimate with you. He's got the swagger of a geriatric pole dancer and the raw sexual heat of Peggy Hill in a meat locker, and he knows what you want. Ain't that right, Dick?
She likes it when, she likes it when, she likes it when.
You don't like it? Sue me. The way you do me.
She don't have to say it, yeah. She likes it when I pour tequila, cause she knows.
I'll be honest, I'm kind of at a loss here. Trying to critique any aspect of this song is like holding up a sheet of blank loose leaf covered in spit and telling me to make fun of the fifth line down. There is nothing. This song is nothing. It's a nothing song by two nothing men for nothing people to get no joy from. And the fact that something so devoid of substance manages to skeeve me out this much is a phenomenon that deserves to be studied.
She likes when,
stop that. This song sounds like it wants to lick me. The bass hits so hard in support of nothing that I feel like I'm being humped by it. I know the song is about a married man seducing his wife, but it sounds like a guy ogling a woman in her sleep, panting over how hot she is while trying not to be too loud and wake her up. And do not say that this is a me problem. I've got no issue with seduction or sex songs. Gay or straight, intimate or bombastic, they can all be hot if they're done right. But listening to this song gives me, like, whatever the exact opposite of a voyeuristic thrill is. I said stop that.
She knows by the way that I'm kissing on her that we gon' take our time.
It was right down to the wire as to whether She Likes It or Truth About You was the worst country song of the year, and I went back and forth a whole lot of times. But you know what? Truth About You tried. I believe that Mitchell Tenpenny went into that song with the intention of making something good and emotionally compelling. I could feasibly imagine an alternate universe where Truth About You might be a good song, whereas you couldn't find a universe where this song works if you got Dr. Strange hopped up on cocaine. I got joy out of laughing at what a train wreck Truth About You was, while every second that I spend thinking about She Likes It is a wasted second of my life that I will never get back, which of course leads to the obvious question, how on earth was this a hit? It's an embarrassing, unfinished, rough draft of a song by a pair of smug, self-impressed douche bros that spent a single week at the bottom of the sales charts, a single week at the bottom of the streaming charts, has barely 10 million collective YouTube views, and never even touched the main airplay chart. This song did not crack the top 60 of the Hot 100, and yet it hung around for long enough to be one of the 100 biggest songs of the year. How the hell is that possible?
When I played John Denver through that little boast.
Now, I could be wrong about what I'm about to say. I've looked for hard information and evidence to confirm it, but I wasn't successful. And so I am forced to rely on secondhand accounts for this, but I'm pretty sure I'm right, so here we go. I believe that the only reason this song was able to stick around for so long was because of a fluke in the way Amazon Music streams are calculated on the Billboard charts. If you are a chart watcher, you've probably noticed a significant increase in the performance of country songs over the past couple years, to the point where country music actually beats out pop, R&B, and even hip-hop to be Billboard's most successful musical genre of 2022. There are several systemic reasons for that, but one of the most notable is that country music is heavily favored by Amazon playlisting. There are a lot of people who listen to their music through algorithmically designed playlists, and Billboard usually weighs songs listened to through those automated playlists less heavily than on-demand streams, you know, where people manually click on the song or hear it in a playlist they've manually created. However, for some inexplicable reason, songs summoned through Amazon Echo are counted as on-demand streams regardless of the command that summoned them, meaning meaning that Nashville has been able to give country songs a huge boost on the charts through premium Amazon playlisting. And if what my sources are telling me is true, She Likes It got some of the most premium playlisting of any country song in recent memory. I know I just threw a lot of jargony back-end talk at you, so let me explain to you very plainly what that means. The reason She Likes It managed to become a hit song is pretty much exclusively because throughout 2022, it was one of the first songs that got played when someone said, "Alexa, play me some music." We have now gotten to a point where one of the primary driving forces of the Hot 100 are artificial boosts from the Amazon microphones in our houses, or as it's come to be known, Bayzola. I don't think that I have anything else to add. Alexa, fuck this shit.
She likes it when
Alright, here we go. Just a few more minutes and we will all know what my pick for the number one worst hit song of 2022 was, and spoiler alert, it's not going to be a fifth country song in a row. Before we get to that though, I do have a favor to ask you. I have not made a single dime from YouTube in the half a decade I've been making these videos since I use so many clips of copyrighted songs in these videos, and so I am 100% reliant on my supporters on Patreon to make income from the immense amount of time, effort, and resources that go into making these videos. If you enjoy what I'm doing here, even a small pledge on Patreon would be immeasurably helpful. Pledges start at just $1, literally just 4 quarters every time I upload, and aside from supporting me, you'll get tons of rewards for your pledges, such as voting for what I talk about next, access to a community of awesome people on my Discord server, early access to my videos before they premiere, and direct contribution to my videos through my Grab Bag Reviews series, my fan rankings, and several other community-driven projects I have in the works. More information can be found in the link in this video's description. Thank you so much for your support. And now, on to the Dishonorable Mentions. This was gonna be on the list for the longest time, but honestly, the memes kinda saved it.
Oh, Horace is here!
Doesn't change the fact that this is a gross-sounding r/gamers anthem that makes me feel like I'm sweating Monster Energy when I listen to it. It really is astonishing that this being the theme song for Arcane doesn't even crack the top 50 worst things that happened in the world of animation this year.
I knew Rupert was fake, but I still ate it because I'm a grimace.
There was one moment at the end of 2021 where this song clicked for me, and it clicked hard. Unfortunately, I have not been able to replicate that moment even once since then, and Kodak Black is not an artist worth putting effort into trying to like.
If I was him, I'd say to hell with you, ain't no helping you.
The song is actually fantastic in pretty much every regard, except, you know, for the reason why it was made.
I'd shame me, I'd blame me, I'd make me pay for my mistakes, but I don't think Jesus does it.
If you thought this was the worst hit of the year based on that line alone, I would have very little to argue against that.
Ever felt like this before? Take my name and make it yours.
Moments like this that make me think the wave of boyfriend country replacing all the bro country was like finding an oasis in the desert only to realize it's filled with salt water.
Do a leap. I'm trying to do more with her than do a feature.
Now, I was originally going to retire my channel's long-running gag of me simping for Dua Lipa as hard as possible after I saw her reaction to this song and how clearly weirded out by it she was. Then one day, I opened Twitter and saw this.
So you're telling me there's a chance.
This is what we sacrificed our soul for. We let Dr. Luke continue to have a career even after all his predatory behavior, and he rewarded us with the biggest radio hit of the year. An unchanged, recycled sample over which the winner of a hip-hop talent show from the channel that made the Grumpy Cat Christmas movie raps about big dick energy. I hope it was worth it, kids.
That's the trouble with a heartbreak. It's gonna hang around.
Jason Aldean is just the worst country star on the A-list right now. Like, he's a total douchebag, his music is shit, and he constantly looks like he just farted and is disappointed by what it smells like. What is his appeal, exactly?
I know I'm fine, but the money makes me handsomer.
Look, TikTok pop has hit some pretty low lows over the last few years, but TikTok hip hop is just the death of music.
She said, "I love your songs." I told her to list 5.
Name 5? Well, okay, if you insist.
We promised that we'd stay forever and ever.
You sound like if Akon tried to make a comeback with a Chill Vibes mixtape, and I could not mean that as a harsher insult.
Do you know that I love you? Know that I want you to stay?
Look, we had enough nursery rhyme songs this year. We don't need to be letting literal Muppets on the mic.
Questions I don't have answers to. Like, what did I do?
You feel like home, I wanna go.
Oh, yeah. Do your sexy air conditioner moan for me, Russy baby.
Nothing too big a deal.
I'm starting to think I may have been a bit too harsh on Rit Momney last year.
Feeling like I might just be on the road. I'm never selling my soul.
That feeling when the most replayed part of the big new single you're promoting is an Ed Sheeran rap verse.
When I put the kettle on, it's a number that nobody knows. I stay up the road, live in the sticks, put my profit into mortar and bricks.
And yeah, there you go. That is five of your songs. Play stupid games, win stupid prizes.
We wanna F-R-E.
So, did you know that Rick James actually didn't like Super Freak all that much, and he literally only recorded it because he wanted something on the album that dumb white people would like? Eh, the more you know.
But even with nothing on, bet I made you look.
Literally, the only reason this isn't on the list is because I already had to write the Rich Flex segment in a hurry at the last minute, and I'm too lazy to rewrite anything else. See you in December, Megan Megans. Fuck literally every single individual thing about this.
I got another one. DJ Khaled, 100 racks. I made another one.
I would not have believed you if you told me at the start of 2022 that the worst lyric of the year would come from DJ Khaled, and yet.
We the best music.
They ain't believing us. Juice WRLD did.
DJ Khaled.
A, B, C, D, E.
Okay, well, first of all,
silence, egg!
With that said, yeah, I probably was a bit too hard on this song earlier this year. Gayle is basically the Milli Vanilli of the 21st century, where everyone was so outraged that she was such a phony-ass industry creation that they forgot that they should be primarily outraged at how bad the music sucked. However, in both cases, the public outrage came from a very understandable place. Milli Vanilli became such a punching bag not just because they were lip-syncing, but because their exposure was the flashpoint where everyone realized how sick they were of the tacky, overpolished, bloated, and empty spectacle that made the last few years of the 80s such a miserable time for the top 40. Likewise, Gayle is the one who got caught in 4K, so she's the one who gets to be the lightning rod for the ire of everyone disparaged that TikTok music has become so quickly corporatized and artificial after it started out so scrappy and raw. Really though, I have nobody to blame but myself. I was so excited by the possibilities of first wave TikTok and how many small artists were getting an honest chance, and for some reason I let myself indulge in the fantasy that there was at least one thing in the world that late stage capitalism wouldn't corrupt. I suppose that, in the end, the true egg was me, and now I have to live with it on my face.
Everybody but your dog, you can all fuck off.
Usually when I make these videos, I have to decide early on what I'm aiming to achieve with my pick for the worst hit song of the year. The thing about trying to make a list of the worst hit songs of the year is that not only are opinions subjective by their nature, but what a person is trying to convey through those subjective opinions on a list like this can be constantly in flux. Is the worst song of the year the song that gave the least to you? Is it the song that took the most from you? Is it the one whose existence offends you the most? Or is it the one that most represents everything wrong with the year around it? All of these and more are valid reasons to call something the worst, and one typically has to make concessions in one of these categories to more efficiently fill in another. It's just the nature of the game. However, while 2022 was the worst year of my life, In a certain sense, it did end by giving me a gift of sorts, because my pick for the worst hit song of the year requires no such compromises. My pick for the worst hit of 2022 is the song whose sound I dislike the most. It has the lyrics and attitude I dislike the most. It took the most from me, it gave the least to me, it is the best representation of everything bad about the popular music of 2022. In every way I can think of, it is the most fitting capstone to this miserable year, and I think it's only fitting that it should come from the artist who had one of the hardest fall-offs of the year. And so, without further ado, my pick for the worst hit song of 2022 goes to...
Post Malone, you a bitch! You suck!
That's rude.
Thank you so much.
You a bitch!
You say you love me, but I don't care. That I roll my hand and say what you told me that he fought you.
You know what? I like Post Malone. He seems like a decent guy. And he's made a lot of jams, Ugly and Sweet, High Key and Low. That video I played a few seconds ago, everyone hated that video, because nobody wants to see Post Malone called a bitch. I even felt bad saying that he fell off in 2022, because by all accounts, that album was a pretty compelling reflection into the darkest recesses of his mind unlocked by a year trapped indoors alone. Post Malone is an artist defined by his willingness to tear himself open and bleed. Even when he lights up and has a party, you can feel the weight of the scars from those tears beneath every word out of his mouth, and the fact is that that's just not what people want right now. As compelling as his ruminations may be, we're past the point of dwelling on the misery of the pandemic. The pop music of 2022 has made it abundantly clear that we desperately want to be happy again, and so I can't be surprised that Post Malone's follow-up to the biggest album of the decade so far drastically underperformed sales expectations, firmly slipping him into dormancy as an artist who, at least for the time being, is not a matter of concern to your average music fan. Except for this. I refuse to believe that either of this album's two hits were part of Post Malone's original vision for this project. As far as I'm concerned, Republic Records demanded him to write something they could sell to iHeartRadio. They only let him rip off Circles once, and so after that, he decided to just be passive-aggressive. I Like You was a piece of shit in its own right, but that's because it was a Doja Cat song with Posty's misshapen skin stretched awkwardly over it. One Right Now is not a Post Malone song, but it's not exactly a Weekend song either. It seems to be at the exact halfway point between the two, and it turns out that the halfway point between those two is one of the worst things I've ever heard in my entire life.
You think it's so easy, fucking with my feelings.
I mean, yes, the synths sound like a Chinese knockoff of a Sega Genesis. And yes, they mixed both artists' voices to this homogenous mid-range that cuts all the edge out of Abel's falsetto and all the resonance out of Posty's tenor, so they both end up sounding like they're on a rough demo of an Imagine Dragons song. To be honest, though, I don't really care about that. The specifics of the production don't matter to me as much as the attitude, because this song sounds like it was engineered in a lab to become the single, least thought-provoking musical experience conceivable. This song's production is a printer test page for an algorithm designed to calculate the sound that will get the lowest number of people possible to change the radio station. Every decade since pop music's inception has had its own characteristic sound for homogenous disposable radio slop, but the 2020 specific blend of echoing synthy white noise meant to occupy as much sonic space as possible with no deeper purpose has got to be the worst yet. Especially when it's paired with this fucking composition.
But I got all of what you did already. Body fall, body.
The melody of this song is a goddamn Mobius strip, a never-ending cycle that never reaches a conclusion, just traveling in endless loops, forcing your brain to focus on it against its will in search of an ending that will never come. You hear this bit right here? That, right there, that is not a melody. That is a sonic fractal, a Watch Mojo playlist of audio, the musical equivalent of lying awake at night, exhausted and yet unable to sleep because your brain just keeps on racing through an unending barrage of half-formed thoughts, fragments of meaning with no purpose other than to rev your mental engine in a locked garage, smothering your psyche with musical carbon monoxide, this oppressive, invisible gas that just erodes away at your neurons, making you gasp and choke on this malignant, carcinogenic cloud of nothing. In the world we live in, any second of your attention that a corporation isn't monetizing is a lost dollar to them, and this song is a corporate attention vampire, filling your brain with smog for the sole benefit of their bottom line. That is why this song is number one on this list. I hate that even more than I hate the lyrics. And that is a damn impressive feat, because oh my god!
Said you wanna have my babies, I fucked
you so good, you should pay me.
This is a song about how this girl cheated on him, or them, or fuck it, I don't care. The song makes no sense as a duet. Point is, the girl's trying to apologize, and the dude is having none of it and flexing how easily he's moving on. I easily could have been on the guy's side in this scenario, but after listening to these lyrics, my main reaction is, yeah, I totally get why she was done with your shit, dude.
How many of your friends fit in, bro?
Well, I don't have to deal with you anymore, so I guess I have the green light to go fuck all your friends now. Classy as always, Austin.
But you wouldn't know that, you should call me dad.
Yeah, I paid for your plastic surgery, so you should call me daddy, because I literally determined what your face looks like, just like your actual biological father. Congratulations, Kim Petras. Rhyming daddy with addy with Fendi with daddy is not the most puke-worthy use of that term from this year. And I'm sure by now you've heard this chorus a million times on the radio, but have you ever paid actual attention to what he's saying?
You say you love me, but I don't care. That I wrote my hand on the same word that you told me that he fought you on.
That might actually be the single worst line I've ever heard.
That I wrote my hand on the same word that you told me that he fought you on.
It's a horribly constructed sentence, it's uncomfortable, it's disquieted, it's juvenile, and the levels on which it paints this guy out to be a miserable, pathetic, horrible anchor on the neck of everyone around him just boggles my mind. Yeah, I'm calling it. One Right Now has the worst chorus of all time, especially considering how it ends.
You think it's so easy, fucking with my feelings. I got one coming over.
I've got one bitch I don't care about who wants to fuck me coming over later, and would you look at that, it looks like I'm talking to another one right now. Just an ugly, hateful, miserable chorus from a guy who's more than happy to spread the misery he brings to the world to anyone and everyone. I mean, my instinct is still to root for Post Malone, but man, this is the kind of song that really changes the way you look at an artist. Here I was thinking Devil in the Form of a Whore was intentionally an over-the-top line meant to convey the deepest, most soul-rending depths of his pain, but if this is just the kind of shit he blurts out without thinking just to fill a corporate mandate, that has some really not great implications about the kind of guy he is. In the end, I guess it's to his benefit that this song's entire structure is so antithetical to the concept of deeper engagement that simply reading the lyrics feels like looking too deep into it. The name of these two videos I put out is The Year Pop Music Died, and I mostly did that because I needed a clickbait title to make up for the views I lost by getting out my 2022 videos so late. But throughout the course of this video, I think I have outlined a wide variety of ways that I am legitimately concerned about the future of popular music in the sense we now know it, and One Right Now is a perfect storm of all the things that are worrying me the most. What better representation is there of the worst the media of 2022 had to offer than two men saying awful, hateful, deplorable things, but most listeners not even noticing or caring because it's all coated in a brain-rotting cloud of the-moment static haze that's too numbing to be worth the energy to engage with. I've been accused by people of looking too deeply into simple pop songs before, and over the past couple years, I've made an active effort to try taking things as they are without always bringing the discourse into it. But if there's one thing I've realized making this list, it's that the algorithms to keep us distracted keep getting better and better at their jobs. The goal of mainstream pop culture, now more than ever, is to make us complacent with what we see in front of us, and discourage us from engaging with anything that isn't on the surface level. And so, if me and my reviewing colleagues are gonna make mistakes, I would much rather we err on the side of overthinking shit rather than underthinking it, especially if it means garbage like this doesn't get off totally scot-free. One Right Now by Post Malone and The Weeknd, the worst hit song of 2022.
I got one coming on the way right now.
Please do me a favor and write a comment or two below discussing what you thought about this video, the music I talked about in it, or literally anything else. Interaction is hugely important to YouTube's algorithm, and so along with liking, subscribing, and joining my Patreon, comments are some of the best appreciation you can show if you enjoy what I do here. While you write your comments, let's take a moment to sit back, relax, and listen to what some of my patrons had to say about the hit songs of 2022. From Megazard regarding Pink Venom by Blackpink, man, this had the potential to be so good. The verses are both hype and exciting, and there's an intense buildup, and you think it's gonna explode into perfection, and then the worst hook of the year happens. It almost reminds me of Look What You Made Me Do in that aspect. I really want to like this song, but I never seek it out because the hook just kills the entire vibe. From Nick Cage regarding A, B, C, D, E, F, U by Gale. A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H, I, J, K, L, M, N, O, P, Q, R, S, T, U, V, W, X, Y, Z. From Kanubo regarding Unstoppable by Sia. No, I don't hate this song because an ableist made it. I hate it because it represents all the worst aspects of pop music in 2022. How the American pop music scene was so devoid of any new songs becoming popular that the music industry was able to successfully push this soulless, draining empowerment anthem that only they wanted to be popular. From Jen from Starter Quest regarding Falling Back by Drake, this is just Passion Fruit 2.0, and we don't need another one. Especially not with a creepy music video where Drake gets an Instagram dream girl harem. Those models saying I do in unison makes my skin crawl. Throw that shit in the fire. From Cyan regarding Glimpse of Us by Joji, there's something about this song that makes me think I'll like it every time I think about it. I re-listen to it and I end up not liking it. From Socar Cam regarding Enemy by Imagine Dragons and JID, Arcane may be one of the greatest shows I've ever seen in my life, but this song is the sole reason it's not a 10 out of 10. It deserves a much better opening theme than this lifeless pile of trash. From Mike Duggar regarding Sunroof by Nicky Yori and Daisy, so am I the only one who fucking hates this song? Because I've never been able to stand it. The song creates this cute vibe of you falling head over heels for a woman while driving down the freeway with the sunroof out, but because of the production and Nicky Yori's great and checked out performance, honestly I want to rip out my car radio for polluting my ears with this bullshit. Hopefully the radio drops it soon, cause I can't take this anymore. And last but not least, from Tiny Bubbles regarding Broadway Girls by Lil Durk and Morgan Wallen, you know, Morgan, if you really wanted to do something as blatant as I'm not racist, I collaborated with a black person, you could have at least had the decency for it to not be one of the worst songs I've ever heard, okay? Join my Patreon for just $1 per video to submit your own patron reviews of the music you want to talk about. See you next time, and until then, take care of yourselves. I suppose that, in the end, the true egg was me. And now, I have to live with it on my face. Yeah, that's good enough. Ah, it's gross. Oh, that's so nasty. Oh my god, I hate that. Oh god.